people returning to Jerusalem, the rebuilding of the temple, and some seriously bad stuff about how bad interracial marriage is. Seriously, what the Bible says here just isn't good at all. It's time for the Book of Ezra! So, there are a bunch of possible confusions here, which means it's time for...
Confusion number one!
Ezra and Nehemiah are really one book. You see, with books like 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings, then at least the title gives a clue that they used to be one book. But here, Ezra and Nehemiah, there's no clue, so I'm telling you, they're actually one book. Which brings us to...
Confusion number two!
In most English Bibles, the books are called Ezra and Nehemiah. But in some Bibles, you'll find them called 1 and 2 Esdras. Not to be confused with 3 and 4 Esdras, which you'll find in some Bibles and in the Apocrypha. Today we're looking at Ezra, E-Z-R-A, which is sometimes called 1 Esdras, E-S-D-R-A-S. Okay, so a quick recap. In 1 Samuel, the Israelites lived in Israel here. But after Solomon dies, the country splits in two, with Israel in the north and Judah in the south. You can read in the Book of Kings about how most of the kings that run these countries simply suck. Eventually Assyria come and wipe out the northern kingdom of Israel and they're gone, they're finished, they are a metaphorical dead parrot.
This is an ex-parrot!
Israel is gone, then in 586 BC the Babylonians come and wipe out the southern kingdom of Judah. Destroy Jerusalem, knock down the temple and take off anyone with any influence or title back to Babylon. So begins the exile. Remember this, you'll need to know about it in future videos. Now, over time, the Babylonians are themselves taken over by the Persians, and the Persians have a different policy than Babylonians. Instead of bringing everyone to them, they let people stay in their own lands and have their own religions and their own temples. So long as they stay loyal and pay their taxes, then they allow that to happen. So not all at once, but in drips and drabs, the people begin to return to the land. Which brings us to...
Confusion number three!
So it's the people of the southern kingdom of Judah that are returning, but now they call the country Israel, which used to be the name of the northern kingdom, which is a dead parrot.
This is an ex-parrot!
Okay, so the kingdom of Judah is now called Israel. Got it? Good, because it's time for...
Confusion number four!
Okay, so up to now, the people have been called the Israelites, but the term Israelites refers to both the people of the northern kingdom, which is gone.
This is an ex-parrot!
Okay, do we have to play that every time I mention the northern kingdom now? Because it kind of interrupts the flow. Anyway, the Israelites used to be the people of the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom together. But such, the Israelites don't exist anymore, and so slowly the people stop being called Israelites and start to be called either Hebrews or, because they're from Judah, Jews. So the Jews, formerly called the Israelites, are returning to Judah, which is now called Israel, which isn't to be confused with the old country of Israel, which is a dead parrot.
This is an ex-parrot!
That's the story of Ezra, which could be called 1 Ezras, which is one book with the Book of Nehemiah, which could be called 2 Ezras. And if you're not confused now, you never will be. Now, with all that sorted out, we should be able to discuss the book, which we should be able to deal with pretty quickly. This part of the book describes some of the people returning to the land and beginning to rebuild the temple. The rebuilding begins under the reign of King Cyrus of Persia in about 538 BC. There's lots about the priests and the Levites that return. There's some opposition to the rebuilding, which leads to an exchange of letters between them and the king. Finally, the temple is completed under the reign of King Darius in 516 BC. The people then have a huge Passover celebration to celebrate. The second part of the book then shifts into the first person. I did this, we did that, and they think it's because it's the memoirs of Ezra himself. Ezra is a priest and a teacher of the law and again returns to the land under the permission of the king of Persia in about 458 BC. Finally, the book discusses what the writer sees as a major threat. The fact that a whole bunch of the priests and the Levites have, to quote them, mingled the holy race with the peoples around them. In other words, they've married non-Jews. The people then confess their sins, renew the covenant, and throw out their foreign wives and children, sending them away. And that's really not cool, that's racist. I mean, that's just not good. Be clear, at no point does God condone or accept these actions. So that's the book. What are the themes? Firstly, the people are having a major identity crisis. They want to know who they are. Who are they as a people? Jerusalem has become for these people the ultimate symbol both of their nationality and their religious life. That's why they want their temple back. They see themselves as linked to the past, to the promises made to Abraham and David. That's actually also the point of the interracial marriage stuff. They're trying to establish themselves as the people that are linked to those past promises. There's also a tension at the heart of the book. What is their relationship to these foreigners? Is the exile over? The Persian king has allowed them to return and rebuild the temple, but the Persian king is still very much in control and ruling over them. How can the promises come true when a foreign king is in charge? How can they be the people of God that are brought out of Egypt when their children are only half Israelite? Most of the Israelites are gone.
This is an ex-parent.
And those who are left are being ruled over by foreign powers and mingling with them and their cultures. With all that going on, how can the promises still come to pass? That's the tension at the heart of the book. And there we have it, the book of Ezra. God bless, fellow followers.